soon. I have just guided him something. So we are expecting. Aa gaya sir.
What? Aa gaya. He's in the chat box. Okay, I have joined him. Rushi bhai has joined.
Okay.
Rushi bhai is pending.
So Sarojit, just you can further announce once more about the renaming and all these things.
Yes.
Example.
I'm putting a message in the chat box.
Alright.
A request to the participants to kindly please put your mic on mute.
Jain sir, good evening, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir. How are you, sir?
Fine. Good evening. Fine.
Sanjay sir, waiting for your comment to start.
I'm just checking about the Dr. Chetan Patel only. So
he has joined. I have made him the co-host now.
Okay. Hello.
Only Rushi bhai is not here.
Doctor sir, join kar gaya na sir. Okay. Theek hai sir. Right sir. Right.
People can unlock also please rename yourself with your name and company name so you can recognize who else has joined with us. If you are not putting your details in the chat box, please also do put your name, contact number, mail ID and organization in the chat box. We can add you in respective groups. Hello, Sanjeev sir.
Yes, just yes, yes. Second only. Yes, yes.
Sure, sure.
Hello, everybody.
Yes, sir. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Very good. I think evening. We should start.
Welcome.
I would request whosoever is raising hand, Mr. Swastik Jadeja, kindly put your query in the chat box. Harish sir, we are waiting for Sanjeev sir. Also, Rishi bhai is not joined yet. Waiting for Sanjeev sir's comment.
Rishi bhai is approachable, means, or he is trying?
He is trying.
Saurabh ji, yes, now.
Yes, sir.
Now we can start with permission of just to inform Joshi sir also.
Yes, he is.
Yes.
Sir, surely, sir, you can start.
So good evening. This is Joshi sir. All our.
Recording in progress.
So, and all of our learned guest speakers, our today's guest of honor, Dr. Chetan Patel, sir, which is a member of disaster management cell also. He is vice president of Gujarat Medical Council. And he's very busy. And in fact, his knowledge and all these things, it is so much of importance that everybody is always trying to get him in their knowledge sharing this thing. So we have Dr. Chetan Patel with us and Dr. D.K. Sami, who holded a very, very key role and key positions in the field of fire safety and this. And now he is head advisor, fire advisor to the Government of India, Ministry of Home Affairs. and a very passionate person to share all these things. And Dr. Abhay Purendra ji and Gaurav Srivastav also. So before starting, just I would request now our BDMA president, Sri Harish Joshi sir, to please welcome our guest of honors today, and we can start now, sir. So over to Joshi sir.
Yes, good evening. Thank you very much, Sanjeev ji, for having a good word. And I would like to first congratulate you and entire EHS Forum for continuously organizing excellent programs of the interest, means which develop an interest in this fraternity or industrial fraternity in our region, right? And which is helping a lot, right? Various case studies and number of topics what you are covering. It has been, now BDMA EHS Forum is not just restricted to the people of Bharuch, but across the Gujarat as well as across the country, people are actively participating in this forum. That itself shows interest and the topics what you select, speakers you select. So my heartiest compliments to you and your co-chairman, Mr. Bhavesh, and entire team. Respected today's speaker, Dr. Chetan Patel, as Sanjeev ji has already given a basic introduction, he is ex-chairman of IMA as well as also part of disaster management cell and vice president of Gujarat Medical Council. Mr. D.K. Sami, former DGFS and fire advisor, Ministry of Homes, Government of India. Expert speaker, Mr. Abhay Purandare ji, and our own Rushi Shah, is a DGM EHSS in TAS. Welcome to, actually, I was just Gaurav thinking, Srivastav. Sanjeev ji.
Yeah, Gaurav, yeah. Srivastav from IIT Gandhinagar.
Yes. Mr. Gaurav Srivastav from IIT Gandhinagar. Sanjeev ji, I was just thinking, the way you have selected the speaker, yeah, the time duration you have kept is 7 to 8 is too small. Right, and considering a topic, right, that is a prevention of fire and emergency preparedness at hospital, hello, and nursing homes, I think we should scale up this time and the way the eminent speakers are there. Friends, the topic itself speaks a lot. I do not want to be between you and eminent speaker, but it is so relevant because in Bharuch, we ourselves has experienced a major disaster, major fire in Patel Welfare Hospital, and which is eye-opener. It itself is a case study where 18 people died, including two trainee nurses, right? And I was just reading in newspaper, right, in a past 6 months' time, there are more than 24 major fire incidents taken place across the India. I think, I'm not sure about the data, but more than 96 people killed, right? And out of that 96, 35 alone in Gujarat. And out of 35 in Gujarat, 18 were in Bharuch. So even some of my good friends, doctor friends are always telling that ICUs are overloaded, right? And that is as a layman, common people not able to know that overloaded result into what kind of disaster. Many of the reasons, short circuits in ICU, air conditions or ventilators, right? Now, Bharuch having a unique case that near bed number 8, there was a spark in ventilator, right? And then it, through sanitizer, PPE kit, it spread across the ICU and which has took life of more than 18 people. So, very relevant subject. I would like to compliment and welcome our eminent speaker, right, to enlighten the audience with your guidance. And all the participants, I welcome all the participants on behalf of Bharuch District Management Association for your active participation. Thank you very much and welcome all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Joshi sir. We are always receiving motivating words from you, and this is one of the cause we are always trying to get a good program for this region. So thank you very much, sir. And obviously, we faced Taute cyclone also. So in fact, on 29th only, we have again going to brainstorm among our EHS fraternity about the preparedness plan. So how to, what were the good practices and how to make ourselves future ready. So very useful topics are being discussed among our team. So I am thankful to EHS Forum members all across industries. So thank you very much, and thank you very much, sir. So now we are just starting today's event with inviting our today's guest of honor and our first speaker, Dr. D.K. Sami, which is a very renowned person in India and presenting paper to various national and international forums and national, and he has contributed a lot in the field of fire safety in the terms of lots of advices and all things. Now over to Dr. D.K. Sami to start today's lecture, please. Over to D.K. Sami, sir.
Namaste. Thank you very much for a nice introduction. Basically, I'm a fireman. I don't know. I'm a fit person to speak in this August gathering, because what I heard from Mr. Doshi and suppose that you people are devoted professionals towards the fire and safety. Anyway, at the outset, I would like to thank for giving me this opportunity to your association. I'm really honored to be here as a guest of honor to share my knowledge and experience with you. Rather, I would say that I am here to learn from you guys. You it appears that all you are the very experienced person. So I'm sure that I'll get some good knowledge. I can see Mr. Dr. Patel is there, and he's having a very rich experience. I have seen his working. I have shared a lot of things with him. And as a firefighter, my only task is to ensure the fire safety of the entire country. And I am devoted for this. And from my CV, you are aware that since last 38 years, I am devoted to only fire safety. So my horizon or my look is very, very limited. You can say I am a frog in a well who is only devoted to the fire safety, not like you guys as a EHS expert, you know. Anyway, Bharuch, you know, figured out because of recent fire what Mr. Joshi has addressed it. And it is unfortunate that we lost a good number of people. And my job is, you know, to ensure the fire safety. But sometimes I feel that I have not been able to perform my duties correctly, because since 2009, I am keep on sending my advices. Stop the fire incidents in the hospitals. And this advices is based on the National Building Code of India. These advices are based on the standards what has been developed by the professionals. The only part which lacks, you know, itself is the implementation. And I feel that why we people are not ready to implement the good recommendations. What is the use of having the brainstorming session if our end user is not going to listen to us? He is not going to implement all this information. You go refer the document. If you talk about National Building Code of India, it's a wonderful document, man. You just go, you see, and you just go through it, refer it, and you'll find that there are number of very good recommendations. And if you implement 50% of it, you can ensure there is a zero tolerance. Right. So if you implement those recommendations, since 2009, I started issuing the guidelines after the Ambri Hospital. It was a tragic, so far as the hospital industries are concerned. But after that also, you know, the accidents, we have not been able to stop any one of these accidents. And we are losing a lot of precious life. It's pathetic, you know, those who are at your doorstep for saving life, they are losing life. And not only they are losing their lives, but they are nearer and dearer one also losing their life and saving their lives. So it's also sometimes I feel here what we can do. One thing came to my mind is it's better to go out to the user, to discuss with all the owners of the hospital. Tell them this is not the place to mint money. Money is a different aspect of it. But it's better to look from the fire safety point of view. Like what Mr. Harish has just addressed, that the Bharuch hospital fire may be because of the overrun of the facilities. I am not denying that. There is a lot of pressure on these hospitals. They are running 24/7 into few months, right? Our air conditioners, our electrical systems is not meant to take load of this. In addition, we have increased the load of electrical installations by putting so many sophisticated gadgets inside of that ICU. We have increased the number of beds inside of that those ICU, and that's why these accidents are happening and taking place. But I am told that one of the director of Gujarat, Mr. Bishnoi, he has issued a guidelines to ensure the fire safety of hospital by inspecting, by ensuring that there is a proper inspection of air circulation. You know, one of the engineer, Mr. Nilesh, who was part of an audit of Maharashtra hospitals, and his opinion was little bit vibrant in telling that this hospital fires are due to the this gases coming out from the alcohol. This is the fumes which are creating fire in addition to the rich oxygen atmosphere. Because of the COVID patient, oxygen is there, so they are exhaling oxygen, then fumes from the alcohol, ethanol, they are using as a hand sanitizer. So these two things are accumulating in the passage of time, and these hospitals are not adhering to the ICU guidelines of construction. And if there is a central system, and if central system is not there, they are also not adhering to the guidelines that they should have the tilt and open kind of a window, which they are supposed to open it after. They are not maintaining either, or they are not opening the windows. So these are the very burning topics. He has given some suggestion. He discussed with me. He just want me to at least issue the national guidelines. I said, Milesh, I cannot issue guidelines immediately until and unless I correlate your findings with some scientific data collection. So I tried to contact those hospitals, and none of this hospital agreed for that. They failed to maintain the proper circulation. All they said, they are maintaining the circulation. They are opening the windows. So sometimes, you know, it is very difficult to give the conclusion, give the advices. But I am still collecting the information. And now, since you people are more or less devoted towards the safety, and some of you are working in the hospitals, so please adhere to the guideline issued by your director, Gujarat Fire Services, Mr. Bishnoi. In addition, you should also ensure if air circulation is not there in the COVID hospital, make sure that circulation has to be there, and you should maintain the circulation. I think perhaps by doing that, we can reduce a lot many fires. Because these fires are, I had a talk with Mr. Dastur. You must be knowing him, a very, very famous personality in the Gujarat. And he said, sir, in this COVID hospital, hardly we are getting 2 to 3 minutes. And we have some evidence also, some videos are also there. Mr. R.C. Sharma shared while we were giving lectures to the Safdarjung Hospital. MS was there, and he tried to show that your Gujarat, same Ahmedabad video. And through this video, we came to know that within 1.5 minutes, the entire COVID room was, covered by this fire. So sometimes we feel that some of these findings are good. Only thing that we should collect the real data and correlate with this. So these are the few factors. Now, Mr. Purendra is here, and perhaps being a consultant, being a learned man, perhaps he can throw more light. I don't want to take much of your time. Whatever you are now doing, it's a wonderful task. I must congratulate to all the organizer for organizing this thing. This is a burning topic. I think by doing that, we can save lot many lives. So far as guidelines are concerned, all my guidelines, all my advice are available on the government website. If you want, I can circulate to you, Sanjeev, through you. You can I have issued more than 10 guidelines after this Amri fire. After Amri fire, the Supreme Court has also taken the cognizance, and there is a milestone judgment of the Supreme Court. So according to them, there has to be the COVID officer who is responsible for maintaining fire safety of the COVID hospital, and he is accountable to the fire authorities or the authorities, whosoever that may be, because hospital is not only the fire officer is not responsible for the fire safety of a hospital. So many authorities are there, those who are giving them the certificates. But the question is whether all these nursing home and hospitals are applying for the NOCs. We have some guidelines from the Honorable Prime Ministers of India that we should maintain the database of the hospital, and that after that guidelines and instruction, we are in the process of creating a software. Perhaps in the future we will have the centralized database, but from center I cannot do alone until and unless the hospital agreed to provide me the information. And the main purpose of going with this software thing is not watching like a watchdog. It's like that to inculcate the safety habits of the in the owner itself, to ensure that they are maintaining their systems well in time. I mean, whenever it is due, they are going for the maintenance part of it. They are doing mock drills, which are the important part of the hospitals, and they are applying NOC well in time. And by through those software, we just want to send them the SMS, emails to alert them that now look, your maintenance is due. Now look that your NOC pattern is NOC renewal is due. And if in case any help is required, we will try to push lot of advisories free of cost to them, so that they can download it and they can apply safely. So the main aim of Honorable Prime Minister is that that whatever you want to do, to involve all those users inside, so that they can take proper the precautions. I think I have a lot of things, but time is very less. You have given me 10 minutes, and I said I have already consumed that, but I am available for any question and answer. Whatever you want, you can ask me. With this word, once again, I would like to thank all of you. Thank you very much. Jai.
Yeah, so thank you very much, Dr. D.K. Sami. We know you have very vast experience, and time is always. But the fortunate part is that you are so approachable, and we commit up to our participants here, because Bharuch is one of the largest industrial area in our country. So even all the factory medical officers, CHS professionals are already there with us now. So we will always be having your services, your experiences, your guidance all the time. And BDMA, we will be facilitating all. So So thank you very much, Dr. Sami, for presenting. And now,
thank you for giving this.
Thank you very much, sir. And now all the participants, you can put your question and this thing. So now we have a great opportunity to hear Dr. Chetan Patel. He's again a passionate person. So I would request him to present something on the challenges and opportunities to hospitals and medical community due to this pandemic. So this is one aspect. So of course, it's a heavy load, I feel, and we all feel. So what are the challenges and opportunities particularly, and what are the fire safety preparedness which is existing, and something about the emergency preparedness and how from the IMA side. So now over to Dr. Chetan Patel, sir. You can start.
Good evening. First of all, I must congratulate the organizers for organizing a webinar on a relevant topic on prevention of fire and emergency preparedness. This pandemic has created many challenges for the hospital. Some of them are how to increase the infrastructure, how to increase the human resources, how to tackle the increased inflow of the patients, how to cope up with the other patients and require routine surgeries. So, provision of the service to people with mental health problems. This is also nowadays a big issue for the hospitals. How to convince the staff to work daily under emergency conditions and with insufficient facilities and overcrowded wards. Introduction of social distancing required the challenges to the hospitals in a clinical practice. And of course, major challenges, how to deal with the hazard of fire. So at the same time, along with the challenges, this pandemic has opened the door of teleconsultation and telemedicine, along with the concept of home-based treatment. And in future, this home-based treatment may solve many, many indoor of the patients. So what we see for the prevention of fire or the preparedness, I will shortly brief. First, we see that each and every hospitals and the nursing homes are using multiple electric appliances, right? And these equipments can cause serious hazards if not properly maintained or improperly used. The major hazards associated with electricity in the hospitals are electric shock and the electric fire. We all know that the incidents are increasing these days in the hospitals, and you all know about the recent fire in the Bharuch itself. Definitely there has been increase in the hospital fires nowadays, and the main reason is overstress of hospital system, unable to bear the patient load for the frequent fire incidents, as rightly told by Dr. Sami. Hospitals are increasing their beds, equipment, staffs to admit more COVID patients, but it is not possible immediately to expand the electric wiring system. So medical equipments or the wires carrying the current beyond their capacity can overheat, and overheat along with the environment, which is increase in the content of oxygen, get readily pick up the spark and the hospital fire. What we require fire audit at the same time we require an electric audit also. And you must have observed that most of the hospital fire has started from the ICUs. Why? These authorities of the hospital should know that usually before the pandemic era, the ICUs did not function up to 100% capacity, and our ACs put in the ICUs also do not work 24/7. Nowadays, all the equipments, ventilators, ACs are working 24/7 hours. So ideally, you know that ACs need to run for 15 to 16 hours and then they need cooling period. But it is not possible nowadays. And it has also been noted that the ICUs lack cross ventilation. They are sealed for the purpose of keeping the environment sterile. So in and also in addition to this, there is increased inflammable materials in the hospitals like sanitizers, higher oxygen content in the air, PPE kit. All this spread the fire quickly. So as an authority, we should know all these possible factors which are responsible for the fires, so that we can reduce the number of fire incidents. It is the duties of the owner, administrator, to see that the hospital fire does not occur, and if at all occur, they should be prepared, hospitals should be prepared for that, so that the minimum harm to the patient can occur and the casualties will be less. So for hospital owners, authorities, they should know how to deal with the patient and the patient safety. Patient safety is the priority for any hospital. And for them, I give 4 minimum advice. Always invest in a good fire-resistant wiring. Always use the appliances from the good ISIS market standard companies. Always calculate total hospital electric load. And depending on the electrical load, you keep your gadgets and equipments accordingly. Always invest in a good, qualified and enough human resources. And lastly, but not the least, always go for voluntary accreditation program. If you go for voluntary accreditation program, it will definitely help to your hospital and the patients both. Our experts panelists would discuss in detail, but I would like to say few points on the basis of disaster management. First, each and every hospital should have a hospital disaster management committee and define each member's role and the responsibility. Along with this hospital disaster management committee, you should prepare a disaster management plan, because the most common internal disaster for a hospital is a hospital fire. And this problem is much more with the multi-storied building hospital. Occasionally, it may be necessary to evacuate the hospital, so there should be evacuation planning committee also. And this committee should form a various SOPs. That is very much important. Keeping in view of the following points, first is the evacuation route must be identified. In case of fire, the staff, the doctors, the manpower working in the hospital should know which is the evacuation plan or from where the patient have to be shifted, right? Then consider the advantage and disadvantage of the alternative routes also should be defined. Second is the priorities for the patient removal. Which patient go first and why? Which staff can be co-opted for the patient movement? This all should be defined pre-disaster condition. And movement must be symmetric by moving all patients and the personnel working closest to the danger. Then arrangement should be proper for the removal and safekeeping of all the medical records. This is also very much important. Then you should identify and confirm with that other hospital, other alternative destination, so that you do a mutual aid arrangements with the other healthcare facilities. You should also define the safe areas within the hospitals. You should also make an arrangement and the resources like ambulance and all other vehicles in which the patient have to be shifted, including patients on the ventilators, where they have to be shifted, right then. So all this point, the authorities should keep in mind and prepare their hospital staff duties. And these preparedness duties should be posted in a various hospital places, so that each and every staff should know what he has to do. So each hospital should prepare themselves by following points. First, I have told you the disaster preparedness plan, the committees and all other things. The authorities should know that prevention of fire is most important. So you should know that initial source, initial fuel source, and something to bring them together. So prevention occur through successful action done to heat source, fuel source, or the behavior which brings them together. Then design the hospital and include this design to slow the fire growth. In that, you can use the fire retardant materials, use the fire resistive barriers, and as far as possible, limit the use of linings in the wards. These lining materials are very prone for the fire. Then use the system of detection of alarm fire. So you can use the heat detectors, smoke detectors, or the fire detectors. Use the fire alarm system. This is very important. Whatever method you can install in your hospital, install them, invest in such gadgets. Lastly, use the methods to suppress the fire, like use of sprinkler. I know this is not possible in each and every hospital which are working since many years. But whenever new hospital is being coming up, they should think of this using sprinkler in their hospital. Then another method is confining the fire. So whenever you construct your hospital, use construction barrier which resists the fire. You design your doors and windows to block the fire. So the confining the fire, if at all occur, you should be ready for that. And if all these measures have been failed, and at one place our evacuation committee feels that now hospital has to be evacuated, the patient has to be evacuated. So take the decision accordingly and priorly decide who will take the decision and how to evacuate it. This is also very much important. And one more thing, whenever you build your hospital, always keep two ways out. This is also very much important. These are small basic things, but by doing this, you can prevent many hazards in your hospital. Regarding the electric equipments, train your staff to inspect wiring of the equipment. Replace all frayed or damaged electrical cords immediately. Only equipment with 3-pin plug should be used. Limit the use of extension cord. This is very much important. If you require, then install of a new electric outlet, but not usually use extension cord. And you train your staff that there should be minimum water or the chemical spills near the electric equipments. Ensure that there is an installation of circuit breakers, and all the staff should know that location and how to operate. So this preparedness is very much required for the authorities, doctors working in the hospital, and not only doctors, all the class 1-4 staff. So for this, you require the training and the mock drills. I will speak a few points regarding this, because this is very much important in the preparedness for the hospitals to resist for the fires. So practice makes the person perfect. This is also applied here. Practice at regular intervals along with tabletop exercise, case scenario, and mock drills is very much important. The objective of the mock drill is to review your emergency preparedness plan and your procedures so that whenever disaster occurs, you can be very well prepared for this. Mock drill is an operation-based exercise. More often the staff participates in the training, drills or the exercise, it is the more likely it will be that every member what to do in case of emergency is more aware of it. So drill the exercise, prepare the hospitals for emergencies. And their drills are very much useful to observe that emergency plan is correct or not, and if more training is required or not. So they are good for the practice to re-emphasize the procedures and the roles of the each and every hospital staff. So hospital should also know that how the mock drill should be arranged. They should ensure that every staff should participate in the mock drill and schedule the mock drill time so that each and every staff should take part irrespective of their shift. And once the drill is over, the hospital should always analyze how the thing went and decide if changes are needed or not. Actually, NDRF has come out with the standard operating procedures how to conduct mock drill exercise. So, along with this mock drill exercise, hospital authorities should also know about the triage. I am not going into the detail of the triage, but you must have notice on the TV that there is a line of ambulances on the hospital gate where the patients are waiting. In these circumstances, we can decide which patient require first treatment and which patient can be delayed for the treatment. So, this is triage is a medical decision making, the process of prioritizing the patients based on the severity of their condition, so as to treat as many as possible when the resources are sufficient for all to be treated immediately. So this field trial, the area for the trial should be decided prior. The triage color, which the triage officers should be aware of it, like what is black, red, yellow, and green color. I think in a short, I have covered many aspects of the how to prevent the fire and what preparedness each and every hospital should be. Anything more points, we can question and answer. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Doctor. And you have rightly, nicely covered all these things. In the meantime, I would request all the panelists to please keep eyes on the chat box also. So ultimately, the question will be coming to you after the session is over. So this will be a good practice. And we acknowledge the presence of the PhD SP Parmar sir from Gujarat Pollution Control Board. And our Dr. Rakesh Dubey is always with us, and from Disaster Management Institute, Bhopal. Lots of eminent personalities are attending this webinar, and lots of hospitals are there. So, as announced, you kindly mention all your email IDs and all these things, so that in a short span of time, we will not be able to cover all, but we have the knowledgeable resources, and we will be providing all the solutions to you. This is one commitment from PDM. So now, so thank you very much, Dr. Chetan Patel, sir, for sharing this thing. Now we have one eminent speaker from IIT Gandhinagar. In fact, I would like to share with all of you that all the IITs have been nominated or given some specific charge. So we are very fortunate that in Gujarat, Gandhinagar, IIT Gandhinagar has been developed as a resource center or a center for fire. So lots of experimental works, research works are going on at Gandhinagar, and we are getting lots of updated knowledge from this thing. So one of the devoted person, associate professor, Dr. Saurabh Srivastav, which is working out there, and he's a master of design and lots of knowledge in the field of fire. But we know the time is very limited with us. So now I would invite Mr. Gaurav Srivastavaji to share his experiences. Particularly, we know that this is a situation where the number of beds are sometimes being short. So we need to expand further and make some experiment for COVID care center and hospital. So how to ensure some basics while doing this design, this normal operation, existing hospitals and the COVID care centers which are being constructed. Now over to the Gaurav Srivastavji. Over to Gaurav Srivastavji.
Thank you very much, Sanjeev ji. I hope my screen is visible. I'm trying to.
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So, firstly, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to speak at this forum. Fire safety is a subject very close to heart, and although I'm not working on the field as much as many of you have been, I will try to share some of the academic insights or those kind of angles. So this is the overview of my presentation. The photograph on the right hand side is the unfortunate incident in Bharuch. So we will go into a little bit of principal causes, although it has been primarily covered, so we will try to make it quick. I will try to cover some design considerations for upcoming hospitals, for existing hospitals where capacity is being stretched, and also I will try to cover a little bit about situations where a hotel is being converted to a COVID care facility and things like that. I will try to cover a little bit of what improvisations are possible in the current scenarios. Followed by summary. So this is just a timeline of the fires that I have been able to document. Of course, I might have missed some here, but basically this is more than 20 fires. And the number in the brackets is the number of people who died in each of these, and that is unfortunately more than 90. And it has happened since last year. But what is interesting is that in February there was no fire, perhaps because the system was getting back to normal. We were all thinking that the wave has passed, but then suddenly in March things began to pick up, so a number of fires there. Then April is the largest number of fires in the month, April, the month of April, and May is still going on. So I hope we don't see any more fires, but when the systems are stretched, these things. And it's not just an India-centric problem. There are some other countries where as well things get stretched, some kind of problems. So available resources, I think there are many. The general principles are available from the NBC. There are NABH guidelines. There are other codes and standards. There are always some local standards, municipal guidelines which are available. In fact, regulations which are available. Then COVID-specific guidelines also many organizations have mentioned and published. This is just a representative list. This is not an exhaustive list. I think almost every state by now has reviewed this issue at their level, and they have issued guidelines covering these aspects. So if we quickly move on to principal causes, I think one of them which has been covered is the higher oxygen levels. And this figure on the right is, I think anyone who deals with the EHS or fire safety would be aware of. This is the so-called fire tetrahedron, where there are four components: oxygen, heat, fuel, and chain reaction. And if we take away any of these, then a fire cannot sustain or fire cannot ignite. So basically, higher oxygen levels has been at the center stage for hospital fires even before COVID crisis came. And one interesting thing that many people in electrical safety would know is that if the oxygen concentration of a compartment is less than 16%, then most fuels will not burn in there. Sometimes in server rooms or unmanned electrical rooms, there are devices which are kept to maintain oxygen concentration less than 16%. Here is taken from a study back from 2013, which is showing that this basically studied the effect of oxygen concentration and the pressure on the combustion rate. Sometimes these ICUs also are positive pressure regions where the pressure is more than the outside. So both of them have some impact. And to address this issue, it requires a systemic intervention. It cannot be done at a person's level per se. I am trying to play this video.
Demonstrations on it.
So this is just showing the effect of higher concentration of oxygen. The thing on the right is an oxygen concentrator. There is a line running through it, and the person is trying to burn a cigarette, and he's just trying to show that under normal conditions how the cigarette burns. It is like this, and then he will put this oxygen pipe through that cigarette. And if you see. Now this becomes like a firecracker, so it becomes almost like a matchstick. The temperature, the flame intensity grows, so that indicates that the temperature is now much higher than earlier. And of course, the rate of burning is also much higher. So this is what fire, the intensity of oxygen can do. This is again now a fabric. Under normal circumstances, this fabric would not perhaps burn to a great extent. So this is under normal conditions. So here it's, the flame remains small, one can easily extinguish it. But when it is enriched with oxygen, which is in a greater oxygen percentage level, then the rate of spread becomes very high. So this is how, and these are a few things which we have been seeing across different fires. The other components of this tetrahedron, one of them is the heat or source of ignition. And most of the times it has been the electrical related issues, again primarily because there is overloading which causes heating of the circuits, and so this combined with the higher oxygen concentration and sometimes also with the volatile vapors which come from, let's say, sanitizers, all of these combinations make it much more unsafe inside an ICU. So for these, there are systemic interventions which are certainly required, but at individual vigilance level also, a few things can be possible. So now quickly moving on to design principles, I think the main design principle has to be that prevention is better than management. So we should design our systems so that we don't have to manage a fire, but we are able to prevent a fire. So before we really move on to prevention, one aspect related to management is the egress capacity. This is the number of exits required and how many people can escape, that kind of thing. So there are three tables which give guidance from NBC in this, tables 3, 4 and 5. Now here I've just tried to show a very quick calculation. Again, this is a sample calculation. It doesn't apply to any specific scenario. For each particular setting, the things will be different. But the idea here is that if there is a hotel, there is a school and there is a hospital, where there is a floor area of, let's say, 100 square meters being considered. Once we take all of these into considerations, the number of exits required, theoretical, for the same, so there are two things which are constant across these three columns. One is the floor area, which is 100 square meters, and one is the width of one exit door, which is 1000 mm. So now if we just look at this theoretical calculation, a hotel occupancy will require 8 exits as per design. A school occupancy will require 3, and a hospital occupancy will require 20. And the reason for this is that the occupant load, which comes from this table 3, that is considered to be 15 for a hospital as compared to 12.5 and 4 for the first two. And the second reason is that this capacity factor, which comes from table 4, this is 2 times for hospital compared to either the hotel or a school. So if a hotel or a school has been designed as per that occupancy and now it is being converted to a hospital, then to check about the design capacity becomes a very important question. Similarly, there are stipulations on the minimum staircase width. So for both a hotel and a school, it is 1.5 meters, but for hospital, it is 2 meters. So again, when a hotel is being converted to a hospital-like setting, this becomes important. So what we can do is we can back calculate, depending on the kind of exits which are available, we can back calculate it. Calculate what is the ideal capacity which remains safe. Then the other design consideration would be compartmentation. So Dr. Patel also touched on it very nicely. Now as per the code, the hospital building has to be divided into compartments of not more than 750 square meters, which means every 750 square meters there has to be a perimeter fire barrier, which means if a fire happens in that particular area, it doesn't go outside that. So here again, it is usually better to use non-combustible materials, whereas these things are bricks or AAC blocks or non-combustible boards. Some of the modern materials such as MDF, which is a wood-based panel, or ACP, these are notoriously known to propagate fire if the usually available variants are used. So for each of them, there are now fire retardant variants available which can be used. But then the choice of materials here can have a significant impact. Now the elements of compartmentation are these five. Similarly, another design consideration is in choice of fabrics. Now, the choice of fabrics can be either for the PPE kit or for the curtain type partition which are used between the beds. This limiting oxygen index can be one parameter which one can check. So we know that ambient air concentration is 20%. So if we choose a fabric which is, let's say, more than 25% of LOI, it is not expected to burn that rapidly under ambient conditions. And this number 25 can be subject to some judgment based on the setting. So for an ICU where we are expecting more than 23-24% ambient, we can choose something above 25. In a normal setting, we can choose something which is above, let's say, 20. So then there are possibilities of these polymers. The most common polymers being used for PPE kits or for curtains are on the right hand side most column. These are polystyrene or polypropylene, polyethylene. All of them have around 17 as the LOI, which means under ambient conditions, they will burn very rapidly. So we can make an attempt to move from very flammable fabrics to less flammable fabrics as a process. And investing in a good detection and a prevention system is always a good idea. Of course, they have to be designed judiciously. Oxygen storage and handling is another issue. It is important. The cylinders are highly compressed. So even a minor accident where this particular cap is compromised, so this will just show that. So this shows how a cylinder can become almost a very heavy projectile, which can puncture through walls, it can puncture through even slabs at times. And you know, some of these accidents have been recorded on camera as well. So if you look at the image on the right, this is not a good way to store cylinders. They have always usually should be chained to a wall. And this is something which can happen quite a bit in makeshift facilities, where there have been no prior thought to include the cylinder banks. Moving on to the improvisations possible. So one of them, as I discussed, is that for soft partitions, we use polymers which are less flammable. So instead of polypropylene, we use polyamide. Now, even polypropylene, there are fire retardant versions available. There are some additives which are included, which make them more fire retardant. Then egress paths, we have to be careful about that. They are clearly visible, clearly lit. And then we have to ensure they are not blocked. This is a day-to-day operational job. And when we are using a makeshift facility, for example, converting a school to a hospital, we can back calculate the safe capacity occupancy based on the exit capacity. Now ventilation system also, Dr. Shami talked about it quite intensively, that a good ventilation system is required to remove combustible vapors, to enable more fresh air ingress. And then, in case of improvised facilities, these can be installed independent of the air conditioning system as well. But for the sake of prevention of infection, they should include HEPA filters so that the air which is coming out of the ICU is not infecting others. Nowadays, there are also these ultraviolet-based cleaning systems for air which are available, which can be installed at the exit and entry both. This is another makeshift option. So let's say if inside an ICU we have a highly oxygen-rich environment, we can use an oxygen concentrator in a reverse mode. So usually an oxygen concentrator will take the ambient air and supply oxygen-rich air to the patient. But in this case, what we are suggesting is, let's say this oxygen concentrator, the outlet oxygen is vented outside and the oxygen-rich air from the ICU is being included here, and then fresh air is being allowed. So that can help in reducing oxygen concentration. And again, these are improvisations which will require more specific calculations before any of them can be used. Electrical systems, I think, have been covered, so I would not go into many details, but I would emphasize that additional wiring, if necessary, should be done. It doesn't matter if it is on the surface. Same thing for air conditioning. So, for example, at IIT Gandhinagar, we have an RT-PCR testing lab where there was a 24/7 AC requirement. So, what we have done is we are using three regular split ACs, but we have included an automatic timer which switches on and off each of them every 8 hour interval. So, to summarize, I think these are some of the key design parameters. Most important, perhaps, is vigilance at all levels. I will leave you with some photos of a project that we did with NFSC students and IIT Gandhinagar students. This was funded by UL, and specifically on hospital fire safety. So these are some of the photos. I mean, here it is showing that the staircases are blocked. This is supposed to be a fire cabinet, where there is trash, electrical wiring is not done properly, heating systems being blocked. And then the fire exit plan is not so visible. I think with this, I will stop. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gaurav Srivastava, sir. So, rightly, you have pointed out the presence of flammable material in the PPEs also, the PPE kit and the exit arrangements also. So, thank you very much. And now, in fact, again, I request you to please keep eyes on the chat box. Lots of questions are there for you also. So, we will be answering during the course of next thing. Now, I have privilege to invite one of the very, very eminent personality of Gujarat, and not Gujarat. He is working extensively for abroad also, giving consultancies to lots of organizations, and he's really a very good source of knowledge for this thing. So now I would request Mr. Abhay Purendre, so for presenting something on how to do audit, or what are the basic do's and don'ts for hospital. So over to Abhay Purendre sir.
Thank you, Arma ji. I have a small presentation to share with you. I think that will make it easier. So,
Abhay sir, just one request: if you can cover the light behind you, your voice is not clearly visible. Better. So,
okay.
Thank you.
Is my screen visible now?
Yes. Yes, sir. Your screen is visible.
Dr. Gaurav covered did very well right from the fundamentals, so that saves me a lot of time. What I do is I'll just focus on 2-3 basic concepts that I have been seeing in the past 1 year or so related to these hospitals. So I'll be talking about hospitals in general, and then about COVID, what has changed due to the COVID pandemic. So first misconception that we have, myth that exists in our country, is that fire safety is equal to fire protection. So if I provide sprinklers, I provide detectors, then that's it. I'm done with fire safety. Now this is totally incorrect. Fire safety is only fire protection is only one part of fire safety. And this is what we do normally. What is done on projects? People go to table 7 of NBC part 4, they see what is required. I require extinguishers, wet risers, I require a sprinkler system. They will put that and they believe that that hospital is safe. Nothing can be more false. So when I'm talking about fire safety, actually fire safety consists of various components. And I have shown them here. Different countries follow different terminologies, but you will see here there is fire prevention, fire protection, egress, compartmentation, and response. Fire protection is only one part of that. And when I'm talking about fire safety, I need to ensure that I maintain the minimum levels for each of these components. So, do we do that? Do we ensure that we have sufficient egress? Do we ensure that we have proper compartmentation? That's a question that we need to ask ourselves. I have the answer, and if you look carefully at our hospitals, I think the answer will be obvious. And of course, this level of safety is different for different countries. For example, what is acceptable in our country may not be acceptable in a country like the USA or any developed country. So once again, whether we are meeting the minimum requirement that are prescribed by reports, even that is a question mark. This is a simple diagram which comes from an NFPA document, NFPA 550. And you will see here that we basically have two fire safety objectives whenever we are talking about a building, including a hospital. First is to prevent fire prevention in the first place. And the second is to manage the impact. In the event of a fire, we manage the impact, right? So in this, we try to manage the fire, one, and we try to manage the exposed. When I'm talking about managing the exposed, I'm talking about life safety. I'm talking about egress design, what Dr. Gaurav focused on. So I need to ensure that people are protected, people can find their way out, or if they are to be protected at their place, which is the concept for hospitals, then I should have the arrangement like that. And if I go down this table, manage the exposed, then you will see that either I limit the amount of people in the hospital, which is not possible currently, and I try to safeguard the exposed. So when I'm trying to safeguard the exposed, again, I have two options. One is I move the exposed, which I can do in normal buildings. The other is defend the exposed in place, which is what we do in hospitals. So please remember that in hospitals, the concept is not of evacuation. The concept is of defending the exposed in place. So I must have arrangements in my building to ensure that I can defend the patients in their location. And this is important because those patients cannot evacuate on their own. Now you will see here there are different requirements stated here, and fire protection appears nowhere here. So whether I put extinguishers, sprinklers or any other system, it's not going to help unless I have the arrangements to defend the exposed in place. Implementing code provisions, I am seeing some comments that the NBC provisions are not clear, which is true to an extent. There is some ambiguity, some confusion, and there is a requirement of some sort of clarity with respect to what is stated in the codes. So, which I have been myself pointing out for a long time, that it should be clarity or a document which provides. Hopefully, we will have such clarity in the future. But what we need to do is we need to implement the code provisions in spirit, not just for obtaining an NOC, because obtaining an NOC is not going to help when an incident occurs. So we have the National Building Code of India, and if you have seen part 4, then we have the section on fire prevention, life safety and fire protection. Once again, I would like to point out that fire protection by itself does not help. We need to ensure that all the requirements related to fire prevention and life safety are also met, which currently, unfortunately, is not being done. Chapter 6 is a very important chapter on additional occupancy-wise requirements. So this is the section which gives you specific guidelines related to different occupancies, including hospitals. Nobody visits this section of NBC Part 4. For example, if you go to this part, it says that principle of progressive horizontal evacuation is of paramount importance consideration for hospital patients, particularly those lacking self-preservation. And what we do is we don't evacuate the people, we move the occupants from a fire-affected area to an adjoining area at the same level through a fire-resistant wall. Okay? So this is the concept. And if I have a floor, I need to divide that floor into two compartments and ensure that in the event of a fire, the occupants can be moved from this part to the adjacent part. And because the partition is fire rated, it will provide me protection to these occupants for a certain period of time. At the same time, I need to ensure that the number of patients which are in compartment A can be accommodated in the open space in compartment B. Now, how many hospitals in our country do you think have this kind of arrangement or have incorporated this feature in their design? I seriously doubt about the percentage that you would come in. So when we are, and there are of course different other specific requirements which are very clearly stated, which unfortunately are not taken care of. So when we say that the codes are, and I frequently hear that we have followed NBC Part 4 in total, and when you go there and see there is no compartmentation, there is no arrangement for moving patients. So unless you implement each section in spirit, there is no point in implementing the code. There is clear requirements to ensure that operation theaters, delivery rooms, all these are separated from the rest of the building by fire rated construction. Recently there was a news item, I don't know if you noticed, that there is a fire in Russia. And there was an operation, heart operation going on at the same time. And the doctors continued to operate in spite of the fire. The firefighting went on for almost 1.5 hours. At the same time, this operation was going on with the heart of the building. So this is a standard requirement. If an ICU, if an operation is critical, operation is going on and there is a fire incident at that time, you can't stop the operation. So you have to protect the operation theaters in such a way that operation can go on. So these are standard requirements which need to be taken care of. I'll skip these. And of course, when we are talking of COVID hospitals, we need to understand what are the hazards and how we can control them. So I I'll take another 2-3 minutes. And typically hospitals have different occupancies. So we have some very high hazard occupancies such as laboratories, OPD areas, and medical waste, garbage collection. These are all high hazard areas typically in hospitals. Presence of medical gases, especially oxygen. See, the hazard of oxygen that we are experiencing is nothing new. It is known, and if you look at any code from UK or USA, any NFPA code, it already addresses all these aspects. We are talking about hand sanitizers, that it's a new hazard. It's not a new hazard. It has already been there. There are specific restrictions on how much hand sanitizers are to be allowed in a certain space. So all these are clearly written down. Maybe our code doesn't address it, but if it doesn't, then we need to look at codes which do and we need to implement them. Ignition sources. Now, when we have oxygen-rich environments, then what do we do? Even ordinary ignition sources which do not ignite a material under normal circumstances can easily ignite materials in an oxygen-enriched atmosphere. So we need to think of this and to see how we can make proper arrangements. And already this has been deliberated upon, this has been brought about by the other speakers as well, that as the hospital expands, as we are doing now, then what is the electrical load, how our electrical equipment is working 24/7, whether that can be taken care of. And there is a lot of information available already. There is a code on oxygen-enriched atmospheres, which has been in existence for more than 35 years. So there is a lot of information there that we can use. We can apply it in our current scenario. Only thing is we need to look for the proper information. For example, this is from the NFPA handbook, and it says that potential ignition sources in hospital oxygen-enriched atmospheres include electrosurgical units, lasers, which you would never think would ignite under normal circumstances. Even electric sparks, friction sparks, can cause ignition in oxygen-enriched atmospheres, heated objects, static electricity, short circuits, defibrillators, and others. And when we're talking of fire protection, remember that, as Dr. Gaurav pointed out, when you have an oxygen-enriched atmosphere, the temperatures are higher, the heat release rate is higher. Your ordinary normal fire extinguishing appliances may not work there. I have read an article which says that dry chemical powders don't work in oxygen-enriched atmospheres. Your sprinkler, which has been designed for a certain type of fire, will not put out a fire in an oxygen-enriched atmosphere. Also, because the ignition and flame spread is very fast, the actuation has to be very quick. As you can read here, automatic actuation occurs in less than 1 second of the perception of detectable flame. So these are aspects that we need to consider. Probably we need to come out from, as a society, we are a risk-tolerant society. We are not risk-averse. But with so many incidents taking place, I think we need to change our attitude. We need to try to reduce our risk-taking or risk-tolerant attitude and move more towards a risk-averse attitude. So with this, I will end my talk here. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. We know all our speakers are really a powerhouse or a knowledge center for all these things. Obviously, the time was too short, but it's not an end, but it was just to trigger. So, in the mind of all the HS professionals or the hospital owners, or there to in what direction we need to think and how to.
So yeah, Mr. Sanjeev, this is Dr. Rakesh Chaturvedi from Adani Port Mundra. I am having few questions. I have posted in your chat box also. And would like to ask two questions to Mr. Abhay, because he has raised a very critical concern, that is sprinkler system. So, if you allow me to ask question.
Okay, just
Yes, of course. Yeah.
Because Abhay has thrown a very precise focus on having a water sprinkler system will not work in ICU or oxygen rich environment. I also believe the same thing. But why, what is the reason people are nowadays focusing to have a water sprinkler system in all ICU? First thing is that, which Abhay Purandare is specifically clarified, that this it should be operate within 1 second, which is not possible, as he already written an article on same here told. Second thing, application of water-based system will going to worsen the situation of ICU critical equipment. Ventilators and all things are there. They are facing crunch of resources. If such type of fixed fire detection system installed and due to malfunction or in a small fire, water will flooded on such critical equipment, then how do we going to ensure the life safety of these critical patients? Because we don't have any backup. Like, even though we don't have any backup in air conditioning system and all the things, these are running on stress. So I would like to more I would like to hear on this point. And somebody is saying to have a water mist system, trolley mounted water mist system in each and every ICU with two firemen. So these type things are floating. It seems the lack of awareness to our fire safety professionals, or they are doing their own whatever they believe that is right.
Thank you, Dr. Chaturvedi. As Dr. Gaurav pointed out, that when you have an oxygen-enriched atmosphere, I'm specifically talking about an oxygen-enriched atmosphere when I said that a sprinkler system would not work. Because the sprinkler system is designed to control a certain size of fire in terms of its heat release rate. Okay, now because you have additional oxygen, more material is going to react and the combustion rate will increase, your heat release rate will increase. So whether that sprinkler system, which has been designed to control a fire of a certain heat release rate, now because the heat release rate has increased, your oxygen enriched atmosphere may have much higher oxygen. So that is the reason why these systems will not work. And similarly, portable extinguishers, which would normally work under normal situations, will not work. So I read an article where it was said that the application rate should be almost 50 liters per minute per meter square. So here we are talking about a fire which is affecting combustibles there. Yes, the risk of other equipment getting damaged would be a challenge. And in that case, I think to have some sort of localized application on a fire would be more a solution rather than a full system which activates in the whole area. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, and one more question. Why we are not giving thought on fire prevention? There are technologies like hypoxia environment, which is already mentioned in NBC, but nobody is having a willpower, or he is having a less knowledge about that system. Because fire prevention, you need to work only one point. If we are going to have a protection, each hazards having different protection level, people are suggesting have a fixed oxygen detector there to monitor the oxygen level, to have a sprinkler system, to have a fire alarm system. All these we are giving thought only to fight the fire instead of to give a thought how we can prevent this fire. Like Gaurav, Dr. Gaurav shared that IT server room is having a oxygen concentration less than 16%. I think I'm not able to understand on what basis he has told these things. Because if you are having a hypoxia environment fire prevention system, or there is a mechanism, then only you can achieve the oxygen level below than 16.
Comment on that quickly. So IT, we don't have that system. But there are isolated electrical rooms which are unmanned where these systems are used. And the basic, I think, thing is that below around 16% oxygen concentration, most materials would not burn. But these electrical rooms usually maintain around 18-19%. Going to 16% is...
Yeah, because I am also having an IT server room. But we have never seen such type of oxygen concentration less than 16. Because I have practically bring a truck from this...
Dr. Rakesh, I think you have asked a lot of questions. Let others to ask...
No, sir, my question is related to how we get achieve 16%.
My point, just sir, you are mixing a lot of things. Actually, your question is little bit, you know, like a over designing of the system.
No, sir. My question, design, sir, my query is that.
Just listen to me.
Yeah, sir.
Listen to me first. Whatever system has been designed, whatever system has been prescribed by the National Building Code of India, it is based on certain parameters.
Yeah.
Now, what we are assuming is like there is a oxygen rich atmosphere.
Yeah.
And I told in my opening remark, it is yet to establish whether it is a man-made fault. They failed to maintain the circulation, as Dr. Gaurav also said, that there is a mechanism while constructing the ICU, the air supply has to be 6 in 1 hour. So if they fail to do that, then there are chances of, you know, increasing accumulation of the fumes as well as the oxygen-rich atmosphere. So for fault of someone, you want to change the entire design. You have started talking that you should not put the sprinkler. You should not, you just go with the hypoxia system. I mean, we have to study, we have to...
No, no, sir. My question was not related to ICU. My question is related to IT server room, UPS room, which Dr. Gaurav had stated that they are getting 16% of oxygen concentration and there is no fire in IT server room. My question was related to IT server room.
Nobody is stopping. In server room, nobody is stopping to use inert gas system. In server room, nobody is stopping to use whatever the inert...
No, sir. Sir, my question was related to...
Let us please do not discuss. Right? Let us move on to another question.
Because there should not be some miscommunication because my question was related to IT server room.
That is what Mr. Sami and Mr. Yeah. Gaurav has already answered.
Yeah.
Right. Let us do not have a more debate into that right now.
No issue.
Already we are running out over time.
No issue. Right? You are running.
Let us take some of the questions.
Yes, boss. You are running. Right. Mr. Sanjeev, you are running short of time, but people are also devoting time to you. If you are not able to allow them to have a question, okay.
Right. Then there is a question related to fire prevention better than fire fighting.
Hmm.
Right, that is okay.
Yeah.
I feel air change is key for all this.
Yeah, this is again a suggestion. That is why I have told this thing. And if people are listening any webinar, they need to be given some sufficient time to ask few queries. Otherwise, they are also giving precious time to you, like you told, running short. Then it is...
Yeah. Yeah, Chaturvedi Sahib, just I would request you to please put all your questions, and since always there is a limitations, but the positive part is all the speakers are with us, they are approachable. So we can, in fact, you can directly interact also, so there is no question at all. So just respecting, and you can have a design discussions also, so a lot of these things you can. You can put your question.
Last point, actually, I just want to add, I was waiting for it. Mr. Patel has also talked about the electrical safety. Recently, you know, the IoT-based system has been developed by a Zaveri company. It is an Indian-made system. And according to them, as per the IS 732, the particular device is capable of shutting off the unit, as well as, you know, if the overheating is there, it will give the indication warning. And it will give the warning to those who are maintaining the system. So they have developed a very intelligent system, which is very good. And whatever, I mean, the concern of Patel sir was very, very, I mean, the true one. Because most of the cause of fire in the hospital is more than 31% is because of the electrical short circuit. So since the new device is there, IOTA based, and I have declared the last time that one should go for it, especially the Government of India has asked for the temporary hospitals. So I said categorically the electrical installation has to be with those devices. I give an official recommendations for that devices, though we have to little bit, you know, correlate the data. As I am again and again apprehension that until unless we go for more research work, we cannot give the 100% you know, the solution to what Dr. Rakesh has asking for the thing. So, but electrical safety connected thing, IOTA based facilities are there. It's a very affordable one, and I request all of you, those who are in the EHS systems, to go for it. It can save you. It is your 24/7 auditor, and it will give you the all information on your laptop, on your PC, on your mobile, that if there is some overheating, some short circuit, some overdrawing, or current is going on, it will immediately give you. With this one, I think I have taken a lot of time. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. And for the information of all the participants, this webinar was specifically limited to the hospital part. Because while discussing and finalizing this thing, we came to know that we should not mix this thing. So the speakers have specifically mentioned that you keep a separate for industry operations and all these things. So we'll be having more time to discuss on that environment. So today we kept one webinar for discussion on the hospital part. It was dedicated to that. So of course, there is no end of learning. So we'll keep learning, and all the participants, you can please put your question, and you can mail also afterward also. So because we are sort of time, so you are most welcome. You put your question through mails, and we will be answering your thing. I am happy to see your interactions, and this thing that we are really on the right path. So since we have left so much of time, so I would like now to thank you very much, all our participants, and just this is one mention that one Rusi sir, he was also supposed to come today, but due to he became COVID positive, so we are praying for his fastest recovery, and he has almost recovered also. So this was the today's this thing. So all speakers have very nicely contributed and put their point towards the subject. So it was grand this thing. So thank you very much,
Sanjeevji. I'd like to, sorry for the interrupt.
Yes,
because I so this is not my subject, but it is a subject of everyone now.
Right.
What I suggest that we should organize this topic again. Indian Medical Association, Bharuch branch, Bharuch and Ankleshwar, right?
Yes.
And we can invite respected Dr. Chetan Patel, Dr. Mr. Sami, and other dignitaries, right? So I think very relevant topic. So at least we can put our best effort to make aware the doctors, hospital owners, right, to ensure proper safety. I think we should plan this, right? This is my suggestion. Yeah.
What I suggest. Yes. I'm Dr. Chetan Patel.
Yes, sir.
So COVID passes out, after 6 months, 8 months, we can have one interactive session, not on webinar platform, but in presence, not on online, offline program for this, along with the doctors of Bharuch and Ankleshwar. In the past, I don't remember now, but I have taken one lecture at Ankleshwar on the disaster preparedness.
Okay.
I don't remember who has invited me, but it must be a medical association and not of an industry. But you can lead and have an interactive session for the doctors.
Sure.
And I think nowadays most of the industries should have one primary emergency preparedness facility also, factory also. One doctor or maybe part-time, they also require by law. So they should also be present in that seminar. So it will be a good program.
Sure, definitely. We'll take it into the consideration. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yes. And Joshi, sir, we are seeing the interaction and interest of persons, so surely we'll conduct one more. And after passage of this COVID, one face to face also. So, with this, any.
Sir, I would like to add one thing. I'm Milin Shah. Just one very, very valuable suggestions to all the speakers and all the participants, sir. If you allow me to speak for 1 minute, sir.
Very quickly, if you can share your experience.
I just render suggestions to all the government officials and all the doctors and all the stakeholders of the hospitals to have a joint conference on fire safety every year in every part of the India, to have a sufficient knowledge rendering from doctors to fire brigade and fire brigade to doctors to ensure the fire safety in a real way, sir. This is what I have seen in Canada when I presented my research paper over there in Burns Awareness and Prevention, sir. But sir, request to all the authorities to conduct this kind of conferences on a regular basis. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I would like to raise one more point. Sorry, we have to sit together and find out. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Please continue.
In India, most of the hospitals are either single owner or one or two doctors owner. They are very small hospitals working in a complexes or so. Where I have observed that they are not able to fulfill the requirements of either NBC code or the fire safety codes of the Nagarpalika or the metros. It is a very difficult for the hospital owners also to fulfill that requirement. Even they wish to implement that. So for them also we have to do something. For a newer upcoming hospitals, right, we can have an stringent criteria. But those who are established maybe for 10 years, 20 years, it is very difficult for them to install all this requirement in their small hospitals. This is just small suggestion from my side for the government officials.
So, thank you very much. So, Joshi sir, anything like concluding remarks?
No. I think I would like to express this sincere thanks on behalf of Bharuch District Management to all the eminent speakers. Very thought provoking, and definitely your inputs will help, and specifically Dr. Chetan Sai and Mr. Sami. Right, who has given a complete light, as well as Mr. Gaurav, also Mr. Purandare. Right, so I express sincere thanks on behalf of BDMA. And definitely, once this pandemic will over, we have a plan for the major mega EHS conclave, as Sanjeev ji has visualized.
Yes.
Right, so I think definitely at that we can have a mega event, right, in a physical form. Meanwhile, we will continue our efforts through this digital platform. And I thank everyone, all the participants, and congratulate Mr. Sanjeev Verma for conducting a very nice program. Thank you all. Thank you. Have a nice time.
Thanks, sir. Thank you very much to all the participants.
Thank you very much, all. Just a small announcement of upcoming programs. Tomorrow we have a CSR forum in which Mamlatdar of Agra Taluka is going to address on development opportunities. On 28th, we have the fourth session of Talent Unlimited series by the Women's Forum. And on 4th June, we have the Business Excellence Forum coming up on the safety, a key for business excellence. So kindly stay tuned to BDMA and attend each program. Thank you, everyone.
And one last humble request, that if you are, your organization is not a member of BDMA, please take up the matter and be a member of BDMA. We are for you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your participation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.